Good evening, everyone, and welcome to another episode of Behind the Wheel. My name is Kenton Blackburn. I want to come on here real quick and just give a quick disclaimer about this video. There is some language, some alcohol being consumed, and we got mooned, but you cannot see it on camera. I hope everyone enjoys this interview as much as I enjoyed giving this interview. Anthony had just won his biggest race of his race car career, and it was a blast to catch up with him after the races. But hindsight being 2020, probably going to have to start doing it before the drinks start flowing. Definitely want to thank Smith's Creek Moonshine. Want to thank Wild Turkey Bourbon, some Busch Light. Want to thank all those alcoholic beverages for being consumed throughout our evening. Also want to thank our live studio audience that we had for the first time. Race fans, please enjoy this interview as much as I do. And while you watch, take a peek at this. Got some pork butts going in today, folks. It is going to be a great one. I cannot wait till race next season, and I can't wait to see you right back here on Behind the Wheel. Enjoy this episode. Good evening, race fans. Welcome to another episode of Behind the Wheel. I am here with Turkey Bowl 15 Midwest A-Class champion Anthony Ferrara, and we're going to start this show off right because we were going to try to do this last night, but we are going to take our shot of some Smith Creek Moonshine right here. And congratulations, sir.
Thank you.
Anthony, man, we were trying to get together and do this last night, and you told me that you were fat and you needed to go eat, and I felt a little slighted.
Sorry, man. It's, you got to fuel the machine, man.
I get that. Apparently, it worked out great because you didn't get the interview curse.
Well, yeah. there is a full-fledged naked butt behind the camera.
And just so you know, Scott Campbell's over here giving us a full moon out tonight, race fans.
He was first team All-State Mooner.
Man, I didn't see a drop of hair on. Did you wax that before tonight?
Yeah.
So over here, off screen, we got a bunch of racers going on here, friends, things like that, celebrating your big win tonight.
They're not friends. Hold on.
They're just here for the booze.
They
see this bottle right here that you got, the commemorative Turkey Bowl Wild Turkey Bourbon right here. And we're going to crack into that here a little bit later. But we're going to talk a little bit about tonight and what happened on the track. Because when you got to the race lead, you didn't look back, even with a couple cautions coming out.
Man, I honestly felt like, so Pete Richardson's a good friend of mine. And I know that I heard on the receiver, you know, choose top or bottom, and I heard 64 is the bottom. I was like, God darn it, man. Like, I know he's the man at the bottom, and he's a good friend of mine. So I was like, Pete's either going to hit this tire or take both of us out. I can't let Pete pass me, you know? And then, it's just kind of rode out from there. I had no clue. I don't know if it's my conscious or whatever, but I could have sworn there's people running me over. I was puckered up, as like I said on the interview. I was a little tight, you know?
I was a little tight. I like it, but, you know, from the announcer's booth, me and Jerry Van Sackle, the voice of Boone Speedway, he came down here and helped us out with Turkey Bowl 15. And I tell you what, he was throwing all the baseball puns out there. We're going to talk a little bit about that here in a little bit. But right now, you, just so you know, when you go back and you watch a replay off SpringfieldRaceway.tv, showmedirt.com, or .tv, sorry, when you watch that replay, you're going to actually see how far of a lead you had. And quite honestly, I've seen Pete Richardson run here so much between Midway, and I've seen him run that bottom so close. I was a little concerned on some of them restarts, wondering how you were going to handle them, because if Pete could get around you and hug that low line, the rest of the field's in a lot of trouble.
Pete's tough anywhere he runs. I he's got some good resources, you know what I mean? Like, he's got a good a book to read off of, but I don't know, man. I know he wouldn't wreck me, you know what I mean, but on the restarts, actually, I'm gonna admit it, but Pete, the week before I came in second, Pete won. Pete was rolling around pretty fast under caution, and I was joking with him today about it, and I was like, If I get the opportunity, I'm going to screw Pete up under caution like he did to me last week. And I don't know if it worked or not, but I definitely give him a little jab about it. I was like, you like my – I said my Pete McCroskey. I told him my Pete McCroskey caution pace just to kind of getting his head a little bit, but I don't know if it did or not. I saw the video at the end. He wasn't very far away, but...
He wasn't, but from the announcer's booth, I think you had about a second lead on him.
Really? I know that the bottom, it was slick a little bit. I felt like I was about to get monster trucked because I was like, man, there's no way I'm going fast. And I could hear somebody. I don't know if it was my conscience. Like I said,
The thing that helps you is Pete had some help in battling with a car coming around the top side.
Yeah, that 23.
Yeah, that 23. Yeah. I can't remember the last name there.
We're
going through 300 cars tonight. I'm surprised I have a voice at this point. I think it's the moonshine.
I guess we need more then, huh?
We might. We might hear...
Where is Bob Watkins? He is the legend. He's the man that...
That man's getting me trying to stay the night here tonight.
I might cuddle him tonight.
Oh, I wouldn't doubt that.
He looks handsome after enough of...
He's over there talking to Scott now.
Yeah.
But so we were going to try to do this last night. You went and eat. And I'm really glad now we didn't, because standing over there as well is Tim Mullins. And I interviewed him one night before the races. And, well, his night didn't go so well. And I'm probably going to have to start switching up these interviews and doing them in the evening after the races because, I interviewed Chris Countryman. He had a rough night. I interviewed Colby Rathbone yesterday. He had a rough night. And so if I just hold off.
I'll say this right here. I plan on having a rough night tonight. So maybe actually rough morning tomorrow.
Oh, it's definitely going to be a rough. Okay. I mean, if you crack, I mean, I know we're cracking into this here in a little bit, but... it's going to be a rough night.
We got to do this on camera.
Oh, it's going to be on camera. That way Hoffman can see it too.
And since Campbell keeps showing his butt, we're going to have to do a butt chug on live TV or live camera.
Well, I don't know if we're going to go that far. My kids watch these, man.
Sorry. Dang it.
I might have to edit that one time. Okay. Nah, we're good. We're going to leave that one live because, man, you race fans, you want to know these drivers. This is what Behind the Wheel is all about. So right now, we're going to kind of dive into these questions right now. Anthony, man, I'm going to get my notebook over here because I'm going to forget these questions even though I've asked them 100 times, even in my head. Some of these are from me. Some of these are from my kids.
Heck yeah.
So that's where these questions are coming. Awesome. By the way, how about that trophy, man?
I mean, obviously it's a looker, but my nephew, he's 13 years old in the victory line. He couldn't carry it. He's kind of a sissy. We're going to get him on a program, but...
Hey, you got to just... Working tires, man. Working tires will make a man out of anybody.
Yeah. He's been driving the golf cart around, so.
Oh, that's your first mistake. He's got to walk.
Yeah. We'll get him. We'll get him straight now. We'll get him straight.
All right. So your first question right here. We're gonna start this off. And Tim over here, he's gonna go down memory lane and have a little bit of flashbacks. But how did you get into racing?
So, man, I was about 5 years. So I was born in Louisiana. My family, we moved to Florida. I was young. I lived about 3 to 5 miles from East Bay Raceway. Everybody from the Little League, the town went to East Bay. You know, that was like the big thing. And I got in close with, his name's Jeff Matthews. He runs open late models, UMP. But anyways, we got in close. My dad sponsored him. He really like took me in as like one of his, he's got 4 or 5 daughters. He used to give us, I raced go-karts, he gave us his truck and trailer to use for the go-kart races. He really helped me out, and I was kind of a leech and just kind of like clung on to him, and I just been obsessed ever since. I kind of became a fan and worked into that.
I like it. Everyone has a backstory of how they got into racing, and I love hearing them because they're all different.
Yeah.
You know, some people grew up at a track. Some people stumbled onto it just going to a track one night and watching the shows.
Yeah.
But now I'm going to jump off script here a little bit because you have a little bit different of a backstory than a... Well, I was talking to Jerry Van Seckel, the announcer from Boone, and you have a little bit different backstory than every other driver he's even covered in his career. And let's face it, that guy's going to be in a racing hall of fame somewhere someday if he's not already there. Yeah. And if he is, sorry, I misspoke. But you have an awesome baseball career, and I'm truly, truly amazed. I'm not really a big baseball guy. I'm going to be brutally honest. Yeah. I grew up Southwest Kansas. Football was a sport.
football and basketball, but I love the sport of baseball. I love the mind games that you can play in the sport. Not only were you a pitcher here for the Springfield Cardinals, which is an affiliate for the St. Louis Cardinals, but you've been called up a few times.
Yeah, I went to my big thing was spring trainings, and I played in Mexico, Canada. It was a good experience. I met my wife here playing in Double A. I think baseball, I was talking to a guy tonight, baseball really prepares you, sports in general, prepare you for, life, getting your first job. I think racing's very similar. Racing's just, it's the most toughest thing I've ever experienced. It's a real challenge, you know. There's so many factors and variables, and baseball helped me, I think, in this sport a little bit. The more I lose, the more I'm in the garage, if that makes sense. It's
like any sport you go into, you have to prepare to win no matter what your outing is. If you're preparing to win coming onto the pitcher's mound, as you were the pitcher, or if you're coming out here to race, if you're not in the shop on a daily basis, you're not going to get in the victory lane, especially out here at Springfield Raceway.
To hit on Springfield, if you win at Springfield, I think you can pretty much win anywhere, at least in the Midwest. But with that being said, like kind of piggybacking what you said, the preparation, I think it goes with anything in life. Preparation, sports-wise, it's more important. Like, you prepare and then you just turn it on and you run, you do your acts or your show. But the preparation is what gets you ready for that certain thing.
It's absolutely a phenomenal story. I love talking about it. I love when I have fans message me on Facebook during a race. Because and every time you're on the track, I talk about it. Yeah. Because it's such an awesome backstory that you've pitched at a very high level. There's very few people make it to that level, and there's so many people that still strive to make it that level. But you're out here. You work for Budweiser.
Yeah. Hell yeah.
And you're out here drinking some Bush lattes. Shout out. So,
Bush lattes are better.
Bush lattes are better, but I will give you that. As we continue throughout this interview, though, we're still going to reference to your baseball career, because to me, that is such a phenomenal aspect of who you are as a race car driver, and I see the carryover from one to the other.
Yeah.
So I'm going to go into the next question here. You got the 33, and there's also a little 71 over here, but I never call that. So I'm going to need two different meanings, because you got two different numbers here. You got the 33 and the 71. So what's the meaning behind these numbers?
So 33, going back to Jeff Matthews and how he started that number, he had two daughters, which they're two years older than me.
Ah, so that's where we're going with this.
They're both there. Yeah. Well, I dated one. Randy, love you, girl. I'm married. I can't. So he got this number. Both Amanda and Randy were both 3 years old. I mean, I was maybe one when they were born. But anyways, 3 and 3, Amanda and Randy, 33. And then 71, my wife, her grandfather, which is, he raced Fairgrounds, Moore was his last name, Vernon Moore. So it was kind of a little selling deal now. I told my wife, if I can buy a race car, there's going to be a 71 on it for Grandpa Vernon. And so 33 was my baseball number, and I got it from Jeff. I raced go-karts when I was younger, 33 has been my number. But the 71 was a little selling point, so I could buy a car.
Okay. But now she's going to know the full story.
Shit.
And you're in trouble. It's man. It goes on YouTube, Facebook, Instagram. You see what that gets posted on there all the time.
I'm not a bad person.
No, you're not. But I tell you what, the moonshine.
Bush light,
the moonshine. Here in a little bit of Wild Turkey is going to be going down. So we're going to continue on here.
Whoa. Important question. Spring rates.
Oh, I don't know.
Don't lie.
Tim sets up my car. Spring rates. I don't know.
We got some chirpers out in the crowd here tonight, race fans.
It's late.
Yeah. The beer has been flowing at Turkey Bowl 15.
Spring race.
Bob Watkins must be serving more than just us.
I don't know, man, but that Smith's Creek, he left that moonshine a little too close to us.
We
he's in trouble because that's not going home with him.
That chocolate silk was good though, wasn't it?
First time I tried it. It's better than I thought it would be.
I tell you, it is the bottom of the Cocoa Puffs bag. And I'm a fat guy, so I can say that.
I still taste it.
I do. And we had a buttercream right after that too.
Yeah.
All right, so the next question, do you have any pre-race rituals that you have to do every night?
So, like, I
well, baseball, you got all the superstitions.
Yes. So baseball, I had a really weird thing where the day before my start, I would clip my fingernails. I'm embarrassed to
We're getting an exclusive right here.
I'm embarrassed to tell you these underwear and these socks have been worn since Thursday. I have showered. I've taken them off and put them back on. But Thursday, I had some really good lap times. Friday, I was like, I mean, I feel a little dirty, but it was worth it.
Barked it in Watson Metal Masters Victory Lane tonight. And that's not an easy task to do, even on a regular race night here at the Quick Quarter Mile.
This place is the most competitive. The track is always really good. Jerry does a really good job, man. But the competition, man, I if you come here and win, I think you can win at least in the Midwest mod class. You have a chance to win pretty much anywhere.
So with time under your belt, you know, you're getting more and more comfortable in your car. Which driver do you think you emulate with your driving style?
Man, I really don't.
If you say Kyle Larson, the interview's over.
No, that I couldn't even wear his jock strap if he wears jock strap. But man, I think I kind of pick a lot of people's brains. Dustin Mooneyham is who kind of pushed me to get into racing or car racing, and so I take a lot of he talks a lot, and I kind of take his experience that he's learned. He kind of passes it along. Like tonight, I was really running the bottom, slick track. He is notorious for being a bottom
feeder. Yeah, just go ahead and say it.
And then Scott Campbell, they call him the catfish for a reason. I pick these guys' brains and try
Scott
to run.
Scott was running the high side tonight, by the way.
Something's wrong. We need to check his blood pressure. I mean, he's an old man, so we might need to check him.
That's the only lane he had, to be brutally honest.
Yeah. He's old and senile. We might.
He's old.
And we've seen his butt too many times tonight, so.
Oh, man, this is comedy gold tonight, race fans. Oh, woo. So outside of racing, do you have any hobbies?
I've coached a high school age team. They're actually 2023 graduates, so they're juniors now. And so that's why I don't race until August, because I usually travel and coach those guys. And a lot of them are committed colleges, but I don't have time. I just had a newborn son. I guess he's a hobby. Changing diapers has become a hobby. Nothing really exciting.
Changing diapers is a hobby.
Yeah.
Man, that's a chore. That ain't no hobby.
It's not a hobby, but my wife makes
it. So we talked a couple, when John Schneider was here, we were out way back in the pits and we were talking real late because you're still asking a couple days later if the pit shack pay window was still open.
Well, I might need to hurry.
You can send somebody up there for you.
Go up there, Jane. Get my money.
and so what the funny thing, you run over my cord, we're going to have some problems. But anyway.
He can't drive. He's like me. Just stay put, buddy.
So we were talking, and you said that you finally won when your wife wasn't here. Was she here tonight?
She was here tonight.
All right. So there goes that excuse out the window. Because you were talking about sending her to California or something.
Yeah, but you know what?
She's going to hate me after this.
I've had too many drinks, so I would say things are smoother when she's not here. I'll say
we're pausing for some dramatic effect on this one.
The boys get together. I don't know. I need to stop. I love you, baby.
Oh, yeah. Man. The first ever fight happening, marital bout on Behind the Wheel happening right here.
Remember I said, like, I had to put 71 on the car?
Yeah.
It's for sale probably after tonight.
Well, I'm pretty sure you're going to have a lot of people disappointed if that happens. So right now, I say we open this bottle because we're getting close to the halfway point. And I'm going to let you do the honors right there because you're the one that won that.
Well,
we got to clear out these little...
Get the grass out of here.
Get the grass. That's just a little extra protein.
I'll take it.
As he's cracking open his commemorative bottle of Wild Turkey that all the drivers that won here tonight at the Turkey Bowl 15 got a bottle of this. And even had a driver that was underage win, but his parents got the bottle. Had to throw the... All right, so we're going to move on here. How often do you think about racing?
Wake up in the middle of the
night. I mean...
I love having an audience, man, but I need to get a studio for this.
About
every 5 minutes?
Do you want to check my Google history?
I'm not going that far, man. Checking the Google history.
Actually, I don't want that. But I'm constantly, you know, I'm on, there's some pages on Facebook. I think it's like modified.
Look at this guy over here.
Get in there.
Just got to come cruising by, right?
That guy's lunatic. I like him.
Right?
I love him.
Oh, man. All right. So you're at the racetrack. You can't do anything else but eat what's at the concession stand. What are you getting?
So, kind of another story. My best friend growing up, Shane Burrows. If you look him up, he don't run much out of Florida, but Winter Nationals, which is where all the big dogs go down there, he spanks their ass. Spanks are behind, okay?
Hey, man, that's in the Bible, man.
Ass?
Yes.
Okay, he spanks their ass.
I mean, it's called
his
donkey, but still, it's okay. Still in the Bible.
He spanks their donkey. he's a badass modified guy. He's known in the modified world. I raced go-karts with him, hung out with him since I was 8 years old. I mean, spun the night. Anyways,
what's your favorite food at the track?
Anyways,
you can tell that Wild Turkey went straight to his head.
Yeah, a motor distracts me. I'm sorry, guys. But Shane, we had a thing called Track Max burgers.
I'm following.
We would grade them. Yeah, I don't know if you're a Barstool fan. You have the pizza reviews.
Yes.
I really honestly think we need to have a Track Mac review on a scaling grade.
I guess I know what I'm doing this offseason, figuring out how to set that up.
So, Springfield, I'd give it a
8.2. 8.2?
They actually put a little extra seasoning on it this week. I don't know if they're trying to impress people. It was quality.
I tell you what, this past few weeks, them cheeseburgers have been on point. Throw a little bit of onion, some jalapenos on there. Ooh, man. You're stalking right up my alley. Yeah. There is a reason I have not lost a shred of weight.
Hey, I don't want to be a Debbie Downer, but Jerry, can you buy a dang mayonnaise? Do you not have mayonnaise? What?
Yes.
Are you
Tim Mullins is off camera. 100% agreeing
and
wanting some mayonnaise.
Are you too cheap to buy mayonnaise? Jerry, come on, brother.
Hey, I'll send it up the chain and see what we can get done.
Ask Jerry what the hell's going on. Is he hogging the mayonnaise?
Oh, man, he's probably over in his RV slathering himself up in it.
I know, he's wiping his face with it. Come on, Jerry, give us some mayonnaise out there.
Some tan lotion going on there. And, Scott Campbell's holding your winnings. How's that feeling? As you can see, you came home with a big old fake check here.
Yeah, but I probably owe it to him because he's the best masseuse in Southwest Arkansas.
Oh, so that's why he was dropping his pants early. Oh, all right.
Can I get my crew chief?
Oh, yeah, get your crew chief in here.
Jane Tipton, get the hell out of here.
All right. So if you could run any track in the world, any car in the world at one race, where would it be and why?
So I don't think I'm good enough to, like...
Skill level doesn't matter.
I think East Bay. East Bay is, it's not going to be around for another 5 years. They sold to the fertilizer plant there. I grew up watching that place. I've seen Kyle Bronson run pure socks. I've seen it's just got a lot of sentimental value there.
I
would love to go to East Bay. If there's ever any chance I could just go there, just go race there. I've been there. There's a lot of drunks here tonight.
Richard Harrington back there. I can tell that voice from anywhere without even having to look.
I've never seen Richard.
He's going to crash an interview.
Anthony Ferrara is a cheater. He is a plum cheater.
I love that edit right
this
there.
This is the first time I've seen Richard not flying off turn three.
So. Oh, I'm telling you, girl. Hey, he's over here drinking.
Remember early in the interview, I said I was white trash.
Yep.
Has it not proven like all my people? I got a 12-year-old with.
Oh my goodness! Oh, this is pure comedy. As we go on through, I'm not even gonna ask you this next question.
I'm not gonna drink after Richard. I'll say that.
I'm not even gonna ask you this next question because it's your favorite sport, and we've already talked about it. And it's gonna be baseball.
No.
No, no, don't even lie to me.
Baseball is boring.
Don't even lie to me.
So,
and here comes Show Me Dirt.TV. Thomas Shaw's coming to crash the party. Coming over here to party. Oh, my goodness.
Hey, you gotta show your butthole like everybody else has.
Whoa, 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 whoa. I don't want to edit that one. At least Scott did it off camera. No.
Yeah.
This is why I do this before the races, before the alcohol.
This is legendary.
Yo, if this doesn't get like 500 views, at least 500, we're going to have...
Wait, 500? We're going for 5,000.
All right, let's just go viral, all right? Let's just go viral. It's not on my Facebook because I'm banned.
You're about to be really banned.
YouTube, Instagram, Facebook, Twitter.
There's buttholes, titties. We've seen it all now.
Oh man, I need another shot. I need another shot dealing with these yahoos out here tonight.
Put your crown on.
In all fairness. For the episodes of Behind the Wheel, I got Tim Mullins behind the mic behind the camera right now. I have never had a live audience. I've had maybe one or two people, but I got a pretty good live audience right now. Oh God, Thomas, get out of here! All right,
I love it.
This is
that's all you got, Thomas? Come on now.
Whoa! Oh, who's got them dollar bills?
I want $2 bills.
Hey, if y'all have never been to Springfield Raceway, it's definitely Mardi Gras in November.
Why? Where the hell is Jerry at?
Hey, we need some Cecil.
Yeah, and not Jerry Cecil.
Hey, that's mine.
Well, get out of here. Right. Anybody else want some shots?
Hey, you wouldn't give me none.
That's because he's going after the moonshine. What keeps you coming back to Springfield Raceway?
I mean, that's a no-doubter. Surface of the track. Amount of cars. I mean, I could go all day about that. This is like I said, I grew up at East Bay. This track is just so unique, man. I talked to the guy, the 77 I raced against tonight, and he's like, this is the coolest track. I mean, it's just so... It's usually smooth as glass. Will Vaught's a good friend of mine. I do pitching lessons with his son.
You're doing pitching lessons for race car tips.
Yeah, exactly. Switch off. But Will tonight.
He had a heck of a run tonight.
He had a great run. I went over there and I was talking to him. And, you know, he's just like, this is just probably one of the best tracks around as far as surface race. If that guy knows, if he says something, he knows what he's talking about. The guy's, Will Vaught's the man. Just like Dustin Mooneyham. Dustin has really helped me with my racing career. And Dustin's always, he kind of gets on my butt a little bit. He's like, why are you going here? Why are you going? The best track you have is in your backyard. But Dustin's the old, you talking about old people? He is an 80-year-old person and I'd say a 40-year-old body, but he's got a body of like a 75-year-old. He needs to get on the Martha Stewart.
Dustin. Oprah.
Oh, something to. He needs to
clean it. P90X.
He needs to clean it up. Yeah.
All right.
you can't look at Bob without wild laughing.
I can't. Yeah. I can't. Oh man, we've had so much shenanigans going on here tonight. Saturday night, there's no racing going on. What are you doing?
Me and Tim Mullins are going to Southbound.
That's the best answer I've heard on that one.
We're having a bonfire.
And we're going to drag Scott Campbell with us.
Scott Campbell would go, but he only drinks root beer, and he goes to sleep by about 8 o'clock.
I think Scott's going to try to... He's
bored. Speaking of the devil, it's past his...
He's got some chips and dip going on here. Scott Campbell, hey, Tim Mullins just pulling it up.
It's past Scott's bedtime. He's an old man.
He's a little delusional at this point.
Yeah. We need to get him.
But hey, Turkey Bowl 15, man. This is Springfield's Mardi Gras.
Oh, we. Hey.
I'm dubbing it, man.
Listen, I don't. I'm Coonass. I'm from Louisiana.
All right.
I got a Louisiana Coon. I'll show my tits for something tonight.
Hey, man. I ain't got a B cup for nothing.
You know I love you. My tits are very big, too.
Oh, yeah.
We're getting out of hand. We
are really getting out of control tonight.
This is the best interview I've ever had in my life.
And that comes...
I don't want it to end.
That speaks volumes from being a Major League Baseball pitcher.
I don't want it to end. How long can we do this? How
you know what, man? I don't care, because tomorrow I got all day to upload videos.
How many hours...
I don't know, man. I got like a 32-gig memory card.
Well, how long did your phone stay alive? That's why
I don't know, man. It was 100% when I came down here, so.
Oh, we can go all night.
We going all night. All right, so my daughter wants to know, after all the crazy X-rated stuff, when you're recording too, aren't you?
I'm not recording.
My daughter wants to know, what is your favorite animal?
I'm a dog guy.
Every interview we have had, six or seven now, every interview has been a dog.
It's hard to be a dog, man.
It is. What kind of dog do you have?
So, in Florida, my dog Diesel, which my stepdad is taking care of, English Mastiff, big old, he's kind of a sissy, but he's a big old dog. The dog in my house, Boone, my wife, I inherited him from my wife. I don't even know what the hell it is. He's a little rat, but he'll bite you in a heartbeat. But I love it. He's like a little sissy dog.
So I got a 200-pound Shepherd Mastiff.
So I have the English Mastiff. Those are badass dogs.
This dog is the biggest baby, though. I come home from Friday night here at the Turkey Bowl, right? I come in at 2:30. Wife's mad. Understandable.
It happens.
I stay up till 3:30 editing videos, but when I walk in, my dog comes out of my kids' bedroom with a Wonder Woman blanket draped over his back.
That's a good dog.
That's a good dog right there.
You need to cuddle up with that dog.
You know what? That dog was almost getting his nails painted this morning by my 9-year-old daughter.
And he'd probably do it. He'd probably do it.
Oh, he would.
He's bought in.
He lays in between my wife, so he'll get his head and he'll lay it because I... Me and my wife, we've been married 10 years, so like the cuddling stage is kind of old. You know, well, for me it is.
I'm in that boat.
All right, so like I'll roll over and I got a cuddle pillow. And I'm not going to lie, man, I got a cuddle pillow. Me and that pillow, we cuddle hard. But my dog will lay his head on the pillow. And then I wake up because my face is going hot, cold, hot, cold. Because his nose is right up there. I can't tell who's drooling more, me or him.
How drunk were you? The question is, how many beers do you had when you cuddled?
Well, see, that's the thing. I'm not a beer drinker. You could ask my wife. I'm a weekend drinker, and it is typically Captain Morgan because it's only $11 for a good sized bottle.
For what?
Captain Morgan. Captain
that's rum,
Morgan.
That's rum.
Yeah, it's rum. Captain Morgan and that.
You're rich. I'm white trash. I do cheap bourbon, cheap beer.
So, okay, way back in the day, so my cousin Raymond, he's going to watch this show. Love you to death, Raymond. He's like my brother, not a cousin. And we grew up at the racetrack together. All right.
Have a good one. home with a turkey bowl.
Santa, did you seriously go live?
Yeah,
I've heard you guys before yet. Hey, hold on, before
you stop. Yeah, hey. Nope, I got a question first. Who is better, Behind the Wheel or Show Me Dirt?
You know what the best
thing? Both of them.
Hey, Show Me Dirt. I'm going to bow down to Thomas any day.
Nope. You know what's the best?
What?
Scott, turn around and show that butthole again like you did. Don't be scared,
guys. Hey, it's only a 30-day ban.
You were the state champ. You were the butthole state.
Damn, you're
the
moon. You know,
like Andy. Hey, just show us the aftermath of what you're eating. I think I got a second, he said.
Scott.
Okay, we're not live.
Hey. I missed the opportunity. Oh my goodness. What an absolute blast we've had here tonight.
Turkey bowl.
So my cousin Raymond, I kind of forgot where I was going. So one summer, right, we were at the track Friday, Saturday night, two different tracks. So we would get a keg Friday night because our sponsor was a liquor store. And every street stock, pure stock, however you want to call it, hobby stock, we called them Thunder Cars.
Yeah, they're different everywhere you go.
So, and we would, for every car we put on the track, they would give us a case of beer. Well, we started pumping so many cars out of our shop for the free beer, he ended up just starting giving us a keg of night. No matter when we wanted a keg, we'd go into a liquor store, Black Jack's, down there in South Dodge City, we could go and get a keg of beer. And so every night we'd get a keg of beer, and we both get a bottle of E&J.
And what the hell is E&J?
Oh, it's some cheap brandy, like $7 for a bottle this size. You want to get drunk on cheap?
Oh, I think I know what you're talking about.
Oh, yeah. Man, it's some cheap brandy. It's some cheap brandy. But we would drink that. And anytime I talk about this, he's like, I think I lost a liver that summer. Because we would drink until we were drunk. And my grandma, bless her heart, we lived with our grandma. She was bedridden. You know, not really bedridden. She was a bigger gal. But she would listen to the police scanner. If we got too loud and the cops got called, she'd start flicking on and off the light switch. And we knew that was the time for all of us to disperse. And we'd come inside. And she'd tell the officers when they showed up, no, they've been in bed since about 8 o'clock.
Yeah.
Of course, they knew better with us Blackburn boys.
Yeah. I wipe their butts at 9 o'clock.
Oh, I'm typically in bed by 8:30 because I get up at 3. I'm a different breed.
I have a hard time believing that.
You really? Have you not seen my Facebook when I go to the gym?
What time is? I know you work out, but
that's when I work out. I get up at 3, drive 40 minutes to the gym, hit the gym, and then I'm at work by 6:30.
So you got to work out in 2 hours.
Yeah, I got to get up to like a 500-pound squat in 2 hours.
You ain't going to no gym.
GP Athletics.
That was impressive.
Right?
You should be on the Matrix.
It's that. Whoa.
Scott and Tim did that.
Hey, my throat's been scratchy since that Pure Stock feature last night.
Getting after it, yelling.
Oh, man, my voice tonight.
So I didn't stay around, but I watched that, and holy shit. So the Pure Stock class at this racetrack, there is 7 cars that could walk away every night.
One of them's right there.
No. He's the only one that can haul out.
He's the only one that can pull away from the field. But the thing is, I felt bad for our local guys last night. I really did, because they were stuck behind some 4-wide traffic that they just could not get around. And 34 James Reed is right over there. He could not quite get around that traffic. And when he did, he was just running out of laps.
He is.
I'm watching you, buddy. I'm watching you.
I've seen him at Monette, though. I've seen him around. Ain't nobody beating that old goddamn station wagon.
And just so you know, I'm going to come to your shop this winter, and we're going to do one of these, by the way. You've been on my list.
Hey, James, just jump over in the middle of me. Do one right now.
Don't be scared.
You can come cuddle. It's okay. Everyone else is cuddling.
Come on, James.
I
put it this way, until the end of this year, I've never seen that 34 station
okay,
wagon
so
lose.
I'm going to be brutally honest. I've been at Springfield Raceway since June. Yep. I've been announcing since June. And this is probably, other than the gym, this is the greatest heal for depression anyone can ever have.
I agree.
Hey, what's that mean?
Depression?
I'm stupid.
You're stupid. All right, so I'm going to be brutally honest with you. I've had a couple shots. So about 7 years ago, I actually attempted suicide.
Oh, man.
But what saved my life, my daughter walked in the room right before I pulled the trigger. My wife called the VA. I ended up going to a facility in Sioux Falls.
Yeah, you're
they,
a...
They took care of me, and they got me on the right path. They said, what do you like to do? I said, I like to go to the gym. So I dove myself in the gym. Went from 408 pounds down to 289, and now I love powerlifting. Powerlifting right here has saved my life. But now I have this love right here. I've always loved dirt track racing.
And you're great at it. You do an amazing job. My grandma, Virginia Cowart, she fought in St. Petersburg, Florida. If it weren't for you, honestly, man, she'd have to... I'd have to message her the next day, you know? Like,
right.
And I'm thankful for you, man. Like, but go ahead.
I appreciate that. No, I really do, because even tonight, as the last feature was going, Dave Comer was texting me. Legendary driver. If you don't know who Dave Comer is, and you're watching the show, you need to do a quick Google search, because that man has won just about every big legend race there is to be won out there.
He's the Earnhardt of legends.
He's the Earnhardt of legends. That is the good way to put it.
I said that to Jeff.
You know he lost by 0.072 seconds tonight?
Really?
Drew Papke had him by 0.072.
I think it's good because, you know, Justin, I love that son of a gun.
Oh, man, Justin's a great guy, too.
But he's the man of beating legends, you know, all over the country.
Oh, man, they are. And the way Justin won in Ohio earlier this year with the national
championship.
Oh, man, just absolutely beautiful. Man. And a great representation to the competition we have here at Springfield Raceway on a weekly basis.
And that goes to the B mods. There's, I don't want to name names, but there's probably four B mod guys here that are national champions. If you win here, like I said, going back.
If you look at the top 10 for the IMCA modifies that we run here and the USRA B mods that we run here, there's about 7 in each class that are in the top 10 to 15 cars that run here on a weekly basis that are in the top 10 in national points.
If I could cuss, I would.
You can use innuendos towards cuss words.
If you are a MF-er.
I like it.
You got to be an MF-er to be a C-Sack. This is the place. The best car is
here. Put it this way. If you want to get your name known, come to Springfield Raceway.
If you win a Springfield Raceway, you've done some. Maybe not miss what, you know, B-Mods, A-Mods. Lay models. This is a tough place to win at.
This is a tough place to win, but I got a couple more questions for you, and we're going to wrap this up because we got some more wild turkey to drink, I guarantee you. And what I want to ask you right now is when you're coming onto the track and you're coming out of turn number 4 and the green flag's getting the right wave, what is going through your mind?
Man, it's really weird. I like going back to the sports playing days. I'm so like, mentally, I'm thinking about stuff and that, and then when I get on the track, I have one clear thought. My brain kind of clears out. I have one clear thought, and whether
go wreck.
Yeah, no, it's like if I'm starting on the top, it's like. Get a good start, beat him to the outside. If I'm starting on the bottom, it's like hit the moisture on the bottom. You know, like it's just. I think that's when I played for the Cardinals. I went to Cardinal Core, which is Matheny started that, Mike Matheny, and it's just mental. It's mental coach type stuff, you know, and. I think it goes a long ways, you know, and it's one clear thought. Have that goal and go. Figure out the next goal.
Lap by lap. You hear that quite often, quite honestly. Or either that, or you get the complete sense of euphoria. Yeah. You know, everything kind of goes black around you, and it's just you and the car, you and the machine.
I've had tunnel vision before. Tonight. I've had it. Yeah, it's,
Tonight you were running scared when you had a huge lead over the rest of the field.
Yeah, Pete.
Is that pay window open yet?
I saw you. Hold on.
No, you got paid. Trust me. I remember you got paid. Don't worry. It somehow ended up in my pocket, where we're not going to tell him
that. Oh, you paying that? Oh, here it is. Okay.
So, one thing. You got any sponsors you want to shout out?
Man, so this year, I've really been blessed this year, more so than any other year. So PFI, it's going to turn into...
like a cheaper?
Cavenders. Randy Little paid a lot of money. He's done really good.
Keep going. I got you. Keep going. Don't worry about it.
Bro.
I got you.
You are...
I'm a ninja, okay?
You are definitely a veteran. Like that...
That peripheral vision's always on point.
Golly, dude. But anyways, Randy Little at PFI, he has helped me tremendously. So golf carts, those are golf carts. I mean, they're all over here, sitting over here. He gave me a lot of help, I don't want to say money, he helped me a lot, and he's given me a golf cart. The company I work for, Will Fisher, but Bush Lattes look good on a race car. Frankenstein Fab, Dean Campbell.
Scott Campbell's over there rapping, by the way.
He's probably stealing stuff out of my truck. The whole thing is, I just don't want to see his butthole again.
Me neither. I'm traumatized for life.
Yeah, no doubt. But Aaron Owens, the Owens brothers, man, they've been a huge help. My stepdad, Chris, has been unbelievably helped. He's helped me from the day one, and he told me he's gonna buy me a fire suit. My fire suit, I don't know if the camera can see this, but I have a hole right here. I got a lot of.
Hey, it's a PG-13 show. All right.
Hold on.
Hey. Cecil,
get over here, Cecil.
They need you on the interview.
We're in the middle of the interview, Cecil. They need you.
I kissed his cheek tonight. He's been shaving.
He's mooned us. I got in a lap dance by Thomas. Hey.
He hugged me, kissed me, and I went over and hugged, kissed his wife.
Hey!